Carlos, where was your elf?
Mine was in my bathroom.
My elf was in my Christmas tree.
Mine was in my toaster.
Mine was in my backyard.
Well, at my old school, people made their own elves.
Arnold, where was your elf?
I don't have an elf.
You don't have an elf?
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 I knew I should have stayed home today.
Why don't you have an elf?
I'm Jewish, so I celebrate Hanukkah instead.
Don't Jewish you celebrate Christmas?
Carlos!
Come to think of it, I celebrate Kwanzaa too, but we don't talk about anything else besides Christmas.
Well, why doesn't everyone celebrate Christmas?
Yeah, you get presents.
And Santa comes.
And you can bake cookies.
There's more to it than that, kids. Everyone celebrates different things and thinks in different ways. And the explanation for this is called the field of psychology. Isn't that interesting, kids?
What's psychology?
That's a great question, Phoebe. Does anyone know the answer?
Is that when, like, doctors look at people's brains?
That can be part of it,
yeah. Is that when you sit on the couch and talk to someone?
That's also a reasonable answer. Anyone else?
But that doesn't make any sense. How can psychology be two different things? I just don't get it.
That's a very fixed mindset. Psychology is everywhere. Psychology is many different things. And we're going to practice our growth mindset by going to the magical land of Miller Hall at James Madison University today to see all the different types of psychology. To the bus!
Seatbelts, everyone! Please let this be a normal field trip with a friend.
No way!
Cruising on down Main Street, you're relaxed and feeling good. Next thing that you know, you'll see it. Octopus in my neighborhood. Surfing on a sine wave. Swinging through the stars. Yeah. Take a left at your intestine. Take your second right past Mars. On the magic school bus. Alligator nostril.
Climb on the magic school bus.
Make a plankton too.
Take that.
On our magic school bus.
Drop the river of lava.
On the magic school bus.
Such fine thing to do.
So strap your bones right to the seat. Come on in and don't be shy. Just to make your day complete. You might get baked into a pie.
On the magic school bus.
Step inside, it's a wild ride.
Come on.
Ride
on the magic school bus.
Oh, hello there, students. I'm Professor Kayla Melchiori. I'm a social psychologist, particularly a sociocultural psychologist. What seems to be the problem?
We were wondering why it is that some people celebrate Christmas and some people celebrate Hanukkah and Kwanzaa instead.
That's a great question. Let me tell you all about it. So people vary in so many different ways. They vary by gender, by race, by socioeconomic status, education, sexual orientation, religion, and yes, even what they celebrate or the traditions they they're involved in. So some may partake in celebrating Christmas while others celebrate Hanukkah or Kwanzaa based on their sociocultural upbringing and their heritage. The sociocultural approach analyzes the social, cultural, and environmental cues that influence human behavior. Are there any other questions you all may have? Okay, well, not to mention, we have another related field known as cross-cultural psychology. Here we look at how cultural factors influence human behavior. While many aspects of human thought and behavior are universal, cultural differences can lead to often surprising differences in how people think, feel, and act. Some cultures, for example, might stress individualism, so being more related to the individual, one person, and the importance of personal autonomy. Other cultures, however, might place a higher value on collectivism and cooperation among members of the group. Like your classroom, for example, is a great idea of collectivism. Well, class, I hope I was able to help.
I'm Dr. Holt, the behavioral psychologist. The best way to describe behavior analysis is as a discipline of psychology in which one systematically changes the environment and observes and measures any change in behavior. But that sounds a little complicated. Let me see if I can make it a bit more clear. To start with, behavior is viewed as a function of the consequences, and the way we measure behavior is through matching, or the act of tracking behavior to the environment. The main difference between behavior psychologists is the view we hold, and that we believe in treating the behavior, not the person. So from what Ms. Frizzle has told me about Arnold, it seems like he's exhibiting multiple behaviors associated with anxiety. So instead of treating Arnold for his anxiety, I would instead treat his behaviors themselves. Essentially, I don't approach the world as if something is wrong with you, but rather I approach it by identifying behaviors that need to change and helping to change them. So just remember this, behavior makes up a huge chunk of psychology, and it is that interpretation of any behavior that marks the different psychological perspectives.
Hi, I'm Jessica Irons. I work in behavioral pharmacology and drugs and behavior.
Haven't we already met a behaviorist?
You did. Daniel Holt works with behaviorism on a very large scale, and his area could definitely include mine. The only reason I'm here is the fact that I deal with behavior through the lens of reaction to chemicals. This includes the study of the relationships between human behavior and their dependency or reaction to various drugs. These can be anything from prescription medication to illegal substances. The majority of my research centers around the various ways to encourage healthier drug-related habits, decrease dependency, and observe how exactly different substances affect behavior and natural processes. One of the most exciting studies I've done recently has been looking into something called contingency management theory. This is the idea that the best way to decrease substance abuse or really any undesirable behavior is to continually incentivize good behavior and punish bad behavior. Sounds pretty simple, right? Some of the first studies in behaviorism centered around the idea of reinforcements and punishments for behavior regulation. The funny thing is, though, addiction clinics have a tendency to emphasize punishment for infractions over rewards for abstinence. It's a very small distinction, but it makes all the difference in regards to patient retention. That's one of the reasons why so many fail.
This is kind of dark.
Well, I also work with health choice studies and sleep and exercise stuff.
All of you guys work with sleep studies.
Wait until you get into college. You'll understand then.
Oh, hi. I'm sorry, I didn't see you there. My name is Michael Hall, and I focus my research on sensation, perception, and psychology. As you can tell, I've always been passionate about music, so I knew I wanted to study a field of psychology in which I could incorporate my love for music. Because music is all about what we sense and what we perceive, I knew that this concentration was right for me. Sensation is the process by which our senses gather information and send it to the brain. Perception, on the other hand, is how we interpret what we take in through our senses. I did my very first experiment related to this when I was in college, but I didn't really consider it an experiment at the time. So I sat up on the roof with some of my college buddies, and we had these two big speakers. I thought it would be fun to sit in between them, and as they turned the music louder and louder, see how long I could last. At the time, it just ended with a headache and some good memories, like I'm sure a lot of your nights in college are gonna end up. But looking back now, I realized that I was really testing out the absolute threshold to my tolerance of sound. Now that I'm much more experienced, I love spending my time doing studies that aren't as dangerous, but very interesting, and that I'm extremely passionate about.
Hey everyone, my name is Dr. Fogler, and I study the mind. I'm what you call a cognitive psychologist. I study memory, proper names, false memory, language, cognitive aging, and sleep.
Ralphie is in the bathroom right now, but he loves sleep and daydreaming.
Well, daydreaming is actually the most common form of altered consciousness.
What's consciousness?
That is our level of awareness of what's going on around us and in us at all times.
I'm sure Ralphie is always daydreaming.
Well, the brain likes to do what it wants, and we barely realize it. Daydreaming can happen at any time, and you can spawn in and out of alert consciousness. Ralphie, based on your classmates, it really seems like you use a lot of limbic system, frontal cortex, and sensory cortex. This is what allows you to escape reality.
Wow, that's interesting.
What can you tell us about memory? Because Miss Frizzle always makes us remember a ton of information, and it gets really hard and confusing.
Well, memory is the process of maintaining information over time. The stages of memory include encoding, storage, and retrieval. You can encode something in your memory by visual, auditory, and semantic factors. The storage of memory is how long the memory lasts and how much it can be stored at one time. The famous psychologist Miller suggested that the magic number of the short-term memory is 7, plus or minus 2, meaning there are only a certain amount of slots in which items can be stored. Short-term memory is stored and retrieved in that order, while long-term memory is stored and retrieved by association.
So with this, will you definitely remember everything?
Well, yes, but with school and studying, it's best to give time to memorize things. You learn a lot in school, and studying material in increments such as 20, 30 minutes can really help.
Oh, all right, cool.
Well, kids, let's just say you should study in the way you'll be tested. Study on a deeper level and explain things in your own words.
Thanks Dr. Fogler, you're the best!
Why, thank you guys. I hope you have a great
rest of
your
Are those real?
Hello?
Hello, everyone. I'm Dr. Apple, head of the psych department here at James Madison University. And I'm here today to talk to you a little about social psychology. Now, social psychology is the branch of psychology that deals with social interactions. For a little history of social psychology, some of the most famous psychological experiments deal with the concepts of social psychology, including the Milgram experiment, which dealt with conflicts between obedience to authority and personal conscience, particularly involving the Nazi killings in World War II, and how people were influenced by authority. Another example would be the Zimbardo Stanford Prison Study, which aimed to investigate how quickly the students in the study would conform to their pretend roles as guard or prisoner. However, the study had to be terminated before it finished due to the violence, brutality, and abuse faced by the prisoners.
These are elementary school students here.
I knew I should have stayed home today. Well, who wants to play a game? Hello, everyone. I am Dr. Suedo. Happy to be here. I'm here to talk to you about clinical and counseling psychology. And maybe if you're lucky, as a bonus, I'll throw in some community psychology for a treat. The activities and practices of clinical and counseling psychology often overlap. These activities include assessment, research, teaching, consulting, and administration. Some of the main ones there. They're focused on working with and treating people who have psychological disabilities, such as anxiety disorders, depression, eating disorders, PTSD, that's post-traumatic stress disorder.
The kids already received therapy following Dr. Apple's discussion, so...
Some related fields to counseling psych include school psychology, social work, cognitive behavioral therapy. It's a goal-oriented treatment that makes takes a more hands-on approach intended to help change the way you think and behave. And for that bonus I promised you all, community psych focuses on interactions between individuals and groups. Well, thank you all for your time and attention. And here's a quick video about getting a PhD in clinical psychology.
I want a PhD. I think it's cool that people will call me doctor.
Who will call you doctor?
My patients will call me doctor.
Your patients will call you by your first name and will not even know that you have a PhD. They will be confused that you are a doctor who cannot prescribe them psychiatric medication.
My friends will call me doctor.
Your friends will laugh at you if you ask them to call you doctor.
My family will be proud of me and call me doctor.
Your mother will cry and ask you why you did not become a real doctor. Do you have a boyfriend now?
No, I do not. Why do you want to know if I have a boyfriend?
If you do not have a boyfriend now, you will not find a boyfriend if you go to a PhD program in clinical psychology.
Do you like working with your colleagues in the psychology department?
They are okay, but when you are a clinical psychologist, people think that you are crazy, so you have to always be extra nice so that people don't think that you are crazy.
Professor, why did you get your PhD in clinical psychology?
I wanted to be proud of myself and be able to call myself doctor.
Did it work?
No, I feel even worse about myself.
Hi, my name is Susie Baker, and I found my passion within the largest kingdom of all, the animal kingdom. I always had an interest in psychology, but I found it the most interesting when I widened my view to animal psychology, and now I'm an animal behaviorist. I study how animals interact with each other, with human beings, and with the environment. When it comes to animal behavior, I always question four points: mechanism, development, function, and evolution. When observing my subjects, I primarily use naturalistic observation, which is observation in the animal's natural habitat without any attempt to interact with it. Sometimes, however, I use participant observation with my subjects, in which I actively participate in the environment with the animal being observed. When in the field conducting research, I like to focus my attention on the animal's communication, reproduction, feeding patterns, and cognition, among many other characteristics. Studying animals is my passion. I'm wild about it.
Dr. Christina Jacobson, nice to meet you. As the developmental psychologist on campus, I most often found one of my labs, but you kids got me a good time. Developmental psychology is a psychological field of monitoring stability and change over time, from conception to death, looking at multiple developmental spheres. As a developmental psychologist, I'm mostly concerned with infants and children, although the field has expanded to include adolescence, adult development, aging, and the entire lifespan. This field examines change across a broad range of topics, including motor skills, cognitive development, executive functions, moral understanding, language acquisition, social change, personality, emotional development, self-concept, and identity formation. Developmental psychology examines the influence of nature and nurture on the process of human development, and the processes of change in the context and across time. This could be applied to any of you, for why you do any of the things you do, or say any of the things you say.
Hey kids, my name is Dr. Joanne Brucer. I work here at James Madison University as a professor for abnormal psychology. I also specialize in police psychology and forensic psychology. But let me start off by telling you a little bit about abnormal psych. Abnormal psychology is a branch of psych that studies unusual behavior, thoughts, and emotions. Can you kids think of any unusual behaviors?
Could an example be that Arnold has really clammy hands?
It's a great example. Yes. Abnormal psychologists can usually diagnose these kinds of strange behaviors as psychological disorders. Sometimes we can prescribe drugs to patients that will help alter their behavior. We do lots of things to help people who have psychological disorders. If their behaviors cause them to live maladaptive lives, then we must help them change their behavior so they can live their lives to their full potential. I also work in the field of police psychology. Does anyone know what police psychology is?
Like forensic psychology.
No, it's completely different. No, police psychology is its own thing. I work with the police station providing psychological evaluations of police officers to make sure they're fit for the job. This means that I assess them and determine whether they would be appropriate as police officers. I also have experience in the field of forensic psychology, which is the integration of psychological principles with the law. Forensic psychologists may work in a variety of places, including prisons, government agencies, schools, and law firms, just to name a few. There are a lot of things you can do with these fields of psychology. Do you have any questions for me today? No? All right. Thanks for coming.
Hi, I'm Tracy Zinn. I'm an industrial organizational psychologist. Mostly, we study people in the workplace. I guess that's pretty vague. Do any of y'all know about the Industrial Revolution? Right. Well, around that time, a lot of people were trying to maximize the efficiency of their workers. So a bunch of studies were carried out to see what would make people work harder, faster, and better for longer periods of time. Thus, industrial organizational psych was born. We study all sorts of things nowadays, though. The workplace has changed a lot, so we don't work so much with what makes people work harder, but with what makes people happier and more creative. Most people don't work in factories anymore, so we look at all sorts of new questions, like which unemployment plans are best at getting people back into the workforce. A little open secret for you, America's doing it wrong. Another one of my particular favorite research issues is paid parental leave for following childbirth. Many, many studies show the numerous benefits of this, and Germany is actively instating it as an encouraged, if not mandatory, action. There are plenty of other things that I personally study, such as teaching styles, learning in college, the commodity of sex scale, and cultural perceptions of labor and birth. If you're not interested in research, IO psychology is one of the higher paying psych areas for practical work in large companies. It's also one of the few where you don't need a doctorate to get a job. If you want to know anything else, or if you want me to be around for a little bit longer, you should totally ask me about CrossFit, because I love it.
Yeah. Hey everyone, I'm Professor Jeff Dyke. I heard you guys were learning about psychology. How exciting! I happen to be a biopsychologist. Honestly, any behavior can be described by your natural, neural, and chemical processes, and by your anatomical structure and functions. Biopsychology is a branch of psychology that analyzes how the brain and neurotransmitters influence our behaviors, thoughts, and feelings. This field can be thought of as a combination of basic psychology and some neuroscience. This branch has many names, including biopsychology, physiological psychology, behavioral neuroscience, and psychobiology. Biopsychologists often look at how biological processes interact with emotions, cognitions, and other mental processes. So, really what's happening is everything that's going on inside you is because of all the interactions within your body. Isn't that pretty cool?
Hello kids, my name is Dr. Jamie Kurtz, and I love to be positive and find reasons to always be happy. There are many fields within psychology, and I represent both personality and positive psychology. That being said, can anyone possibly tell me what you might think personality psychology has to do with?
Is it the study of what makes us who we are?
Indeed it is. It takes several factors into account, which include biological factors, Freudian psychology, and culture. Part of what I do is observe social settings and relate it to how it is influenced by individuals' emotion and conduct. I am the person who explains why behaviors such as aggression, persuasion, attraction, conformity, and group interactions exist.
What's positive psychology have to do with that?
Well, positive psychology is the study of what makes life pleasant, engaging, and meaningful. I try my best to encourage flourishing. Can anyone tell me why I should be happy?
Like, don't be sad, be glad.
Well, finding joy and laughter is key to being happy. Happiness leads to creativity, a stronger immune system, better relations, and you're better able to cope with setbacks.
So can you give us reasons to always be happy and maintain enjoyment in everyday activities?
Of course. Part of my research is focused on how we should enjoy our everyday lives, even when they are repetitive. I try to find strategies that can be used to maintain enjoyment.
Well, how do we make school enjoyable?
Well, first, let's think of what kind of things interest you.
Well, I like sports and comic books and science fiction.
It seems like you have a great imagination and are very creative. So whenever you find yourself bored in class, rather than let your mind go somewhere else, try and relate what you're learning to something which can make it easier for you to remember.
Well, how would I do that?
Well, you can take notes and add your own drawings. You can focus on reading about sports and begin opening your eyes to other categories of books.
I don't really like the field trips Ms. Frizzle takes us on. They kind of scare me. How can I find a way to start enjoying those more?
Well, aren't you grateful for having your classmates alongside you on these trips?
No.
I'm sure they'll help make it more fun. Also, try to be more optimistic. You never know what you'll come across. You might find something which you truly love, and Ms. Frizzle is taking you on a journey to find what you could possibly be passionate about.
I guess you're right.
Well, kids, it was great to meet all of you, and I'm sure you will all find something which can make you happy. I was once your age, and there are many things which bring you down, but there are also many factors which you can take advantage of to put a smile on your face. Goodbye, everyone.
Bye, Dr. Kurtz.
Alright kids, so today we learned to take chances, make mistakes, and get sticky. Yes. What else did you guys learn today?
I learned that studying in 20-30 minute increments can really help you retain information.
It's really impressive.
I learned that people are constantly changing over their entire lives.
I learned that psychology is actually psychology.
Carlos.
No, wait, just kidding. I learned that people have a variety of perspectives, and you should always be mindful of differences and take those into account when making a decision.
Carlos.
Yes.
I learned that I should have a growth mindset instead of a fixed mindset.
Oh, yes. Yes, Keisha.
I now have a better understanding of why I celebrate both Christmas and Kwanzaa, and I've gained a better perspective on the world.
It's beautiful. Arnold, what did you learn today?
I learned that I should always go on Miss Frizzle's field trips because sometimes there are like exciting things to learn. I'm glad I didn't stay home today.
So today we took a trip to James Madison University at Miller Hall in the psychology department, and we learned all kinds of different perspectives of psychology. And we learned to have a unified view of the world and all the different aspects of things and minds. And it was magical. We learned how to better ourselves as human beings and be better in every aspect of our lives.
And remember to always get sticky!
Hey! Hey!
I don't understand. I can date a nice sensitive man in my program who also wants to be a clinical psychologist.
There will be a few wonderful men in your graduate program. However, they will all be married or homosexual.